Now a look at your horse inside and out with Dr. Joe Carter.
Today we're here to speak about the current equine herpes virus outbreak that's occurred in the western part of the United States. For those of you that haven't heard about it yet, at the cutting horse show in Ogden, Utah that ended on May 8th, there were a number of horses that became ill with equine herpes virus 1. Equine herpes virus 1 is also called equine rhinopneumonitis, and it's a common virus that we see in the environment, but there has been a recent mutation that's caused a neurologic form where it'll actually attack the horse's spinal cord and brain. And in Ogden, what happened was several horses got sick, a couple actually became recumbent, were down, they had to be euthanized, and then these horses left the show grounds before the confirmation of the diagnosis had occurred. Once the confirmation had occurred, then these horses were isolated at different places around the country, and their ability to contaminate other horses were curtailed. Equine herpes virus is also called rhino, and it also is commonly vaccinated for in our flu rhino vaccines. We also have a vaccine for the abortion form of this rhinovirus called pneumobort. And so this virus is very common in young horses. When you see little crusty noses, it's very similar to RSV type viruses in people, kind of cold type viruses. You'll get a fever, normally a cough, runny nose, that kind of symptoms. And then rarely you'll get this neurologic form where it attacks the spinal cord. In those horses, the bad thing is about 20% of the horses that become infected with the neurologic form will actually die from it. And so we want to take extra precautions when we're dealing with equine herpes virus. The first thing that I recommend is to have your horse vaccinated. There are basically two groups of vaccines for these rhinovirus, and they're called either a low antigenic mass or a high antigenic mass. Now, it's a very complicated term. Antigen is what's in a vaccine that actually stimulates your body to produce the antibodies, and so you can have a lot of antigen in there, meaning high antigenic mass, or you can have a low antigenic mass. There's anecdotal evidence that the high antigenic mass vaccines do offer some protection for this neurologic strain of herpes. So that's one of our current recommendations, is to vaccinate your horse with high antigenic mass rhino vaccine. The second thing that you can do is limit your horse's exposure to sick horses. This seems like common sense, but it's obvious if you've got a sick horse, you don't want to be around it. You need about a 30-foot buffer zone, because if a horse coughs or aerosolizes any of the mucus, they'll shed that virus and it'll float in the environment for 20 or 30 feet, and then you can breathe it and become infected. Your horse can breathe it and you can become infected. The other ways that the horses become infected is if nasal secretions, runny nose, the snot basically of a horse's nose, then contaminates the feeder or a water trough or the walls of a stall. So if you're going to any kind of horse event, we currently recommend that you disinfect and clean those stalls very well. Horse show management should do that after each show, and then you should take it upon yourself to at least disinfect that stall with some of the common disinfectants. The virus is easily killed by most disinfectants, so any disinfectant should work. Any of the common disinfectants should work. Sterilize those stalls, the water buckets, the feeders, let it set for a little while, and then bed it and put your horse in there. Once your horse has shown signs of this disease, unfortunately, there's not a lot of treatments that are available, because most viruses have to run their course. There are some antiviral drugs like acyclovir, valacyclovir, ganciclovir that have shown to have some efficacy with viral diseases in horses, and specifically rhino. Other supportive things are, you know, IV fluids, anti-inflammatory medications to keep their fevers down, all the supportive type therapies that you would normally do for a horse that's not feeling well, running a temperature, has a respiratory problem. Taking your horse's temperature sounds like a simple process, but anything to do with the rear end of a horse is always, there's always a safety issue, and it's something that is often frightening to horse owners, but it's something that you should learn to do. Now, at any drugstore, these digital thermometers, here's a couple of different kinds, are available. They're very inexpensive, and every horse owner should have one in their tack room or in their little medicine box that they have. And all you do is you hit these little buttons, and the temperature will be registered digitally. It's very easy to do. The secret to taking a horse's temperature is, first of all, restraint. You want to have that horse restrained properly. You need someone to hold the horse. You need someone that's there with you to make sure the horse is not going to do anything that might hurt you. And then what you need to do is you need to ease around to the side of that horse toward the rear end and then just gently raise their tail, and then you can insert the thermometer into their anus and rectum. And you should lubricate the thermometer prior to doing it. Any kind of KY jelly or even like tap water, saliva is something that people typically use to do that. And then insert that thermometer and you hit the button, and then a beeper will go off after a minute, and then it'll read your horse's temperature. Horse's normal temperature should be less than 105.5. Typically, horses have a range, 99 to 101, depends on what kind of exercise, the time of day. The best time to take your horse's temperatures first thing in the morning. Get into a habit, you know, particularly say at a show or an event, if you take your horse's temperature in the morning and you notice that it's been running 99 99 99, and then all of a sudden one morning it's 101, that might be the first clue that I better come back in the afternoon and check it. It might be 103 or 104. If you do have a temperature that's greater than 101 or 101.5, you need to call a veterinarian, have your horse examined to make sure he doesn't have some kind of an infectious disease going on, some kind of virus or bacterial infection that might cause them to be sick, especially in light of our current equine herpes virus outbreak. Taking your horse's temperature is very important. Just a reminder that equine herpes virus 1 is not a new disease. The fact that it is a herpes virus may connotate notions that this is something that could be transmissible to people. Well, it's not transmissible to people. They're very species specific. So the herpes virus in horses is no way associated with the herpes virus that humans get. So don't worry about your horse, you know, giving you any problems from this disease. And this disease has been around for a long time. There's been vaccines available for herpes virus for numerous years, numerous decades. And so we've seen reoccurring episodes of this neurologic strain. We've actually had some experience here before with this occurring in some local horses, where we were able to quarantine those horses, prevent them from infecting other horses, vaccinate the horses that were in the vicinity. We were then able to disinfect and clean their stalls. We let them sit for a couple of weeks before we rebedded them and allowed new horses to come in. But the situation can be controlled. Accurate diagnosis, accurate relationship with your veterinarian and any state and federal officials that might be involved are the keys to you managing any kind of problems with equine herpes virus. One of the interesting things about equine herpes virus and herpes viruses in general, if you think about a herpes virus in you where you get a fever sore, a canker sore on your lip, you will harbor that virus in your body, and then if you become stressed, then you'll start to show those signs where you'll get a fever or canker sore. Well, a herpes virus in a horse is very similar. If your horse, almost all horses are exposed to it and develop it as a foal, and then it kind of rests in their body, and then if they become stressed, they might show the fever and the runny nose and some of the signs of that problem. And so even if your horse lives in a pasture and doesn't really go to horse shows or racing events or places of what you would typically think of exposure, you should vaccinate your horse for rhinopneumonitis, because you want to help them control this herpes virus that may be dormant in their body. You don't want it to rear its ugly head, and those vaccines are very effective in doing that.
If you are going to show your horse, you had some recommendations for a vaccine schedule around your show schedule. Do you want to give us that? Is that something you can reel off the top of your head?
Yep.
Okay.
In light of this current EHV-1 outbreak, we've got some individually tailored recommendations that we're giving to our clients. Now, you should consult with your veterinarian about your horses and your particular situation, but in our clientele, we have a lot of horses that go to the snaffle bit futurity, the reining futurity, and the cutting horse futurity. And these are all young horses, three-year-olds. And young horses are somewhat like young kids. You take your little kids to the nursery, they're all going to get runny noses and snotty noses and little fevers. Well, young horses are the same thing. When they start congregating, they start passing these viruses around. And so we typically recommend to our clients to start vaccinating with the different brands. We like to take each company's brand of flu rhino vaccine, because there's all different strains in the environment of these different respiratory vaccines. And each company's vaccine may have a little bit different tilt or a little bit different strain of the vaccine, of the virus in their vaccine. And so what we'll recommend, starting 3 months prior to any of the big futurities for three-year-olds in the Western Performance horse, to vaccinate those horses with each company's brand of vaccine a month apart. And there's three different vaccines, so we'll typically do those, you know, a month apart, with the last vaccination being a month prior to the big event that they're going to. And then prior to that event, there's some immunostimulators that you can actually give your horses to help them ward off any kind of exposure at a show that they might receive. And there's a product called Equistim, and there's a product called Zylexis. And both of these show some help in stimulating the body's immune system in general to ward off whatever they might be exposed to. We think these are very good practices for you to do with your young futurity horses and your show horses or rodeo horses or event horses in general, horses that are going to get high exposure at different equine events. And but I do want you to consult with your veterinarian, because your individual area may have specific little nuances or recommendations that might be necessary for your horse. Once your horse has shown signs of this disease, unfortunately, there's not a lot of treatments that are available, because most viruses have to run their course. There are some antiviral drugs like acyclovir, valacyclovir, ganciclovir that have shown to have some efficacy with viral diseases in horses, and specifically rhino. Other supportive things are, you know, IV fluids, anti-inflammatory medications to keep their fevers down, all the supportive type therapies that you would normally do for a horse that's not feeling well, running a temperature, has a respiratory problem. Equine herpes virus 1 is a very active disease that's going on right now. It's a very hot topic in the equine profession. And I'm Dr. Joe Carter with your horse Inside and Out.